Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A minister friend of mine, Jim Moore, whose books many of you may have read, tells about being in an airport and seeing a young man wearing a white T-shirt, and across the front of the T-shirt was written these words: "When you're a Christian, the whole world is from Missouri." Jim commented on his T-shirt and the saying and told him he liked it, and the young man responded and thanked him and said he had a lot of responses and questions and comments about it. In fact, it was a song title. But in a sense, he said, that's what the world is saying to us Christians today. You know, Missouri is the show me state. And the world is saying to us, if you're a Christian, then show me. Don't just talk the talk, but walk the walk. If you're a Christian, then show me by the way in which you live. And the song title is correct, and so is the young man, because the world, as never before, is saying to us, if you're a Christian, then show me. It's saying, don't just preach it from the pulpit, don't just sing it in the hymns, don't just talk about it in your Sunday school classes. Show it by the way in which you live, by your commitment, and even by your generosity. This is what Paul means when he says, let the manner of your life be one that honors the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you know that in these Sundays during August and September and October, we're talking about discipleship and all phases of discipleship. And today, we're talking about disciples, people of generosity. I read an interesting statistic recently about the frequency with which some words are used in the Bible. For example, believing can be found 272 times. Prayer can be found 371 times. Love can be found 714 times. But giving and generosity can be found 2,162 times. That's three times more than love. That's seven times more than prayer. That's eight times more than believing. Surely the Bible, and yes, God, wants us to be a generous people. Paul talks about generosity in the scripture lesson this morning. He talks about writing to the church at Corinth. In everything you excel, he says, you excel in faith and in speech and in knowledge and in earnestness, and we want you to excel in your generosity. You see, Paul is trying to organize a collection for the church in Jerusalem. The church in Jerusalem is the mother church of all the churches of that day, and the mother church is poor, and they're in need of help. And so Paul wants all the Gentile churches to remember that the church in Jerusalem is their mother church in the faith, and he wants them to make a generous offering to help their mother church. And he uses the following arguments and getting them to be generous in their giving. First of all, he cites the example of others. He talks about how generous the church at Macedonia has been, that even though they're a poor church and they're in trouble, they've given far beyond what was expected of them. And so he uses them as an example and wants them to follow Macedonia's example in the offering that they're making. And then he cites the generosity of Jesus. He says, you remember the generous gift of Jesus that though he was rich, for your sake he became poor, that his poverty might make you rich, that Jesus gave himself for you. Therefore, this should be an example for you to be generous in your giving in response of his generous gift to you. And then he uses the example of their own past record. He said, you have excelled in everything, in faith and in speech and in knowledge and in earnestness. It should follow then that you would excel in your generosity. You see, we are called to be generous people. And in when we talk about generosity, we're not talking just about an offering we would make at church. We're talking about generosity being a lifestyle, the way in which we live, that which permeates everything that we do, that we are a generous people. We're a people of generosity. And when I think of generosity as being a lifestyle, then I think that it has to begin in the heart. It has to be heartfelt. We do something out of our love for something, out of our respect for something, out of something because we want to do it from our heart. I read a real interesting story about a young teenager by the name of Lou and his father. His father was an apple farmer. He worked from dawn to dusk and trying to eke out a living for his family. They lived in a Civil War era house. The only vehicle that Lou had known as a teenager was an old farm truck that they had. And so it was kind of surprising that they bought a new car. And Lou was so excited about it, he wanted to show it off to his friends. And the day after the father brought the car home, Lou asked his father if he could take it for some errands, and his father agreed, and so he excitedly grabbed the keys and ran and got in the car and started the car, and then he realized he'd left his wallet in the house, and so he got out of the car and ran in to get his wallet, and when he came back out, to his horror, the car was gone. He realized he'd forgotten to set the brakes. And the car had rolled down the driveway and across the road and across the area and had gone into to the river that surrounded their property. And so he ran to the edge of the cliff and he looked down and all he could see were the headlights of that car looking up at him as it slowly went under the surface of the water. And he was so distraught, he ran to the house and began to say to his dad, oh, Dad, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. The car's gone, the car's in the river, I'm sorry. And he said later, if I lived, that I have Alzheimer's, the last memory that I will have will be the memory of what my father said to me that day. When he told him that the car was in the river, his father quietly said, well, I guess you'll have to take the truck. Now, that's generosity of the heart, folks. Generosity begins with our... The father loved his son. The son realized that there was no retaliation here. There was no lecture. There was no visible sign of anger. Perhaps the father realized that Lou would be the last person to ever put a car in a river. But perhaps he also remembered that to lecture him at this point in time would only hurt an already hurting son. His was generosity of the heart, and that's where generosity begins. When I think about generosity of the heart, on this day in which we observe 9/11, that frightful day, and we remember those victims, those who lost their lives we should also remember those who generously and heroically gave of themselves to help others. Generosity begins in the heart in response to God's love for us and the way we are generous in how we live and how we give. Generosity not only has to do with the heart, it has to do with the head. It has to do with the mind. I turn to Paul again, who said, as he wrote to the Philippians, having you the mind that was in Jesus Christ, that even though he was in the form of God, he did not want equality with God. He did not seek equality with God, but rather he emptied himself and took on the form of a servant. To be generous, you must be servant-minded. It also has to do with the hand. Paul in the scripture again says, make up your mind what you will give, but do not give grudgingly, but give out of a consciousness of love. God loves a cheerful giver. So you see, when we think about generosity, then we must think about it coming from the heart, and it has to do with being service-minded, and it has to do with having open hands and giving cheerfully. When I think of that and that while we give of our possessions, I think that generosity is more of an opportunity. It's an opportunity and not an obligation. Some people give out of a sense of duty. They give like they're paying their bills or paying their taxes. Sometimes they give with such bad grace that it almost seems like it'd be better if they didn't give at all. Now, remember I said almost, because any gift is worthwhile. But it's enormously more worthwhile if it's given out of compulsion of love. If it's given because this is how you live, then it's given because you can't help but give, because you're responding to God's love for you. And so you want to be generous in your giving to others. And so it's an opportunity and not an obligation. It's an opportunity for you to help someone else. It's an opportunity for you to be like Jesus Christ. It's an opportunity for you to please God. To be a generous person is also a blessing and not a burden. Paul says, you're never a loser because you've been generous. He said, giving is like sowing seed. If you sow abundantly, you will reap abundantly. He also says that if you're willing to give, there's always enough, that God provides the source and also the spirit for giving. And so it's a blessing and not a burden to give. The New Testament is a really practical book, and one of the features of its practicality is the fact that it's not afraid to talk about the reward motive. It says that it does make a difference, that if you live as God would have you live, that those who obey God and those who do not obey God don't have the same kind of existence, because those who follow God's way, there is a joy in that that's not found anywhere else. And so it's a blessing and not a burden. It's a blessing because you can and do help someone. It's a blessing because you've given something of yourself. It's a blessing because you've done the will of God. And Paul finally says to us that God loves a cheerful giver, and that we ought to give not grudgingly, but cheerfully, because of what God has given to us. So I guess that's the profile of a generous Christian. It's one from the heart who is service-minded, who is inspired by Christ's gift of life to us, who opens their hands and cheerfully gives to others and in so doing, pleases God. And maybe the best formula for giving comes from the founder of our own Methodism, John Wesley. It's printed on the front of your bulletin today. Do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. Will you say it with me? Do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our hymn of